Sometimes even the biggest nerd has to leave his habitat. For holidays, for a business trip, or to fix some issues for family or friends. Today I will show you what I usually take with me and why. Maybe it helps to create or adapt your packing list. And I'm pretty sure you will find some tips and tricks for your situation too. Christy YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. Remember, if you subscribe, you will always sit in the first row. When I am at home, I have a lot of things around me, and usually I find what I need to solve a problem. However, when I have to go on holiday or on a business trip, I sometimes also want to work on my projects. Or if my brother calls me because something electronically does not work as he wants, I have to help him. Or if I do projects with my colleagues, then I must select the right few things to take with me. And worst, I cannot easily change my selection when I forgot something. This is why I do what I always do in such a situation. I create a checklist. I learned to value checklists when I learned to pilot small planes. And later, I read this book where I saw that checklists increase quality in many areas other than piloting. As usual, we start with our goal. What do we want to achieve? What are the typical situations where we need to work away from our lab? In the intro, I mentioned a few typical situations. I'm sure you will find other situations in your life. So create your list. As a rule of thumb, you will find a few things that will be useful or needed in most or all situations. And you will find things that are very project specific. For example, if you want to play around with a CO2 sensor, you will need a development board with your MCU of choice, power, some cables, and a CO2 sensor. You also need test equipment, and you need your laptop with a development environment and internet connectivity. I usually use my iPhone in hotspot mode to create a network for my ESP32 gadgets and the laptop. Like that, I also have an independent internet connection from the hotel without the hassle of entering passwords on screens. So let's start to build our checklist with this example. I also distinguish between needed and nice to have. If I travel by car, more nice to have things are in my bag or box. If I stay longer, more nice to have things are with me too. Going by plane usually removes the nice to have things. Because I like its approach, I use mind maps for many purposes. And today I use XMind to create them. Why? Because ChatGPT told me that this is the most popular free mind mapping software. Anyway, as always, we start with the center. We want to create a checklist for a travel kit. As always, I need a laptop with the usual stuff installed, including a mouse and power supply. To ensure I always have the same version of my projects, I enable Dropbox, where I store my projects in a folder and automatically replicate it to this laptop. So I always have the latest release of my projects. And if I change something on the road, I do not forget to update it on my PC at home. Of course, you can use another cloud or GitHub for that purpose. We must not forget a small USB hub if we plan to use more USB connectors than available on the laptop, or if we need different USB types. I'm still old school with my Type A connectors on my laptop. Next is the MCU. This is relatively easy for me as I pretty much standardized on the ESP32. So I always have one of those development kits with me. Why? Because it is easy to connect DuPont wires, and it has lots of ground connectors. To protect the table, I added felt using hot glue, and I added the MAC address. Why? Because of that, I find the board when it is connected to Wi-Fi. On the laptop connected to the same Wi-Fi as the ESP32, the advanced IP scanner searches for all IP addresses in the subnet. Then I quickly find my device if I sort the MAC addresses. This is even more important in the lab, where the device list in my subnet is long. If I want to work with LoRa, I usually take another board with me. I label this as project specific by using colors. Green is mandatory, red is project specific, and yellow is, as we saw before, with a USB hub, nice to have. Of course, I always check if I have the needed USB cables. With this equipment, I can already do basic programming or some experiments to learn something new. But of course, in general, we need a few more things like a display or sensors. I add these in the project specific class. But we always need some DuPont wires. This is why I add those as mandatory. I bought these ribbon cables for years and removed single wires for prototyping. Last year I found these silicone wires. They are relatively expensive, but it is a joy to work with because they are highly flexible and I like to touch them. I reuse them to save cost, so I do not need a lot. If a project is more permanent, I still tear the needed wires from a ribbon and add empty shells on both sides. This looks good and the fit of the connectors is much better. I also add a breadboard with a simple power supply to the list, but in the nice to have category, because I do not always take it with me. If we talk about power, we must talk about a power supply. Most of my projects work on 3.3 and 5 volts, so the USB power of my laptop often is sufficient. If not, there are a few options. One is to use your laptop's power supply to power a variable power supply like that. Most laptop charges are 19 or 20 volts, so you should be able to get up to 15 volts from such a device. You can also use a battery from a power tool for this purpose. I try standardizing on Anderson power poles for all radio-related things and XT60 for the rest. Anderson power poles are good, but maybe you standardize on XT60 because it is cheaper. After all, you do not need a crimper for this system, but you need heat shrink tubes and hot glue. Because I hardly need variable power, I tend in another direction. A power bank or a power brick with power delivery capability. Pay attention that you purchase one capable of more than 12 volts if needed. Not all have this capability, even if it is part of the standard. With such a small board, you can create a cable for 9, 12, 15 or 20 volts output. I prefer the boards with a fixed output because I want to be sure that I get what I expect. This cable, for example, powers my mobile radio station at 15 volts. Or I can use this cable to charge my Microsoft Surface laptop at 20 volts. Or my breadboard at 9 volts. And of course, it also charges all USB devices, some even very fast. For me, the most versatile solution. I place power supplies in the nice to have or project specific category. Next come the instruments. One remark. I do not need exact instruments on the road. Also, very cheap meters these days are okay for that purpose. Size and price are more important. I suggest a small and cheap variety like this Ameng or this B-Side. Both say they are true RMS and offer the needed functions without the capability to measure current. If you want this capability, go for a bigger meter like this good-looking Ameng 682. Recently, I discovered another possibility, the UT210E. It is not cheap, but extremely handy. I have to say, I like clamp ampermeters much more than ordinary multimeters to measure current. There is no need to change the test lead, and there is no risk of destroying something if you forget to switch your meter back and create a short circuit. You also do not blow a fuse if you overload the range. Blown fuses are not helpful if you are on the road. For a long time I had this UT204A. I did not use it often because its 40 ampere range is inaccurate for the small currents I measure. That is why I hit the order button quite fast when I discovered the UT210E with a 2 ampere range. Precisely what my doctor prescribed. I use it often around the house and in the lab, if I need an indicative current measurement. What else? If I do radio stuff, of course, I take the nano VNA with me. But this is definitive, project specific. And I have a nice to have instrument, an oscilloscope. Sometimes it is handy to see the curve of a signal. For a long time I had this DS203. It is tiny and I sometimes used it to avoid the earth reference of my lab oscilloscope. But the handling is a nightmare. If you do not use it daily, you forget how to get things done. And even if you remember, things are incredibly fiddly. This is why I asked Santa Claus last year to bring me another oscilloscope, made for a man with weak eyes and two left hands. This is what he brought. A FNIRSI tablet oscilloscope. Not cheap, and also more a 25 MHz than a 100 MHz device. Still, its comfort with a touchscreen and its possibilities mean a lot to me. Definitely a buy if you want a portable oscilloscope and are not too concerned about precision and can live with a few glitches in the user interface here and there. I have to admit, it is too big for a small bag and not always needed. Therefore, nice to have. The last chapter is about tools. I could say I am Swiss and a Swiss Army knife is all I need. But this is not true. Small cutting and gripping pliers, tweezers and a few screwdrivers are mandatory. Maybe you go for such a set. Also, I have one of these small cutters on my list. They are incredibly cheap for the quality they offer. No plastic. The cutter, of course, is only needed if you do not have a Swiss Army knife. Nice to have or even project specific are larger screwdrivers and pliers, particularly if you plan to work with mains installations. Last but not least comes the soldering iron. A TS80 or TS100 are the classics. They work faster if they get enough voltage. A perfect application for one of the cables with a PD chip shown before. I probably would go for 15 volts. The TS101 is better because it has built-in PD and automatically runs on higher voltage. But not worth the money if you already have a TS80 or 100. Also, a power tool or an old RC battery is an excellent solution to feed the soldering iron. Of course, you should not forget the solder. I cut a few centimeters from my trusted caster, let it solder, and take it with me. I purchased enough of this stuff for my entire life. With solder, I'm traditional, and I stay with lead, even if it's unhealthy. For comfort, you can take flux with you, in a plastic bag, because it can get dirty. Talking about plastic bags, this is my preferred way of packing smaller things, right after my project boxes. For the road, they are ideal because they fit in a small space, often between clothes. The soldering equipment, by the way, is only nice to have. If I go by car, I often use foldable project boxes. They are usually big enough and can be folded away if not needed. We always have a few of them handy, also to package other things for our holidays. I am sure you will help me in the comments if I forgot something, and correct me if I overshoot. This was all for today. As always, you find all the relevant links in the description. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, please consider supporting the channel to secure its future existence. Thank you. Bye.